Lesley Pearse is our guest on the book club this afternoon. And as opposed to talking about Lesley's books, we're going to talk about what Lesley reads over the summer. So it's good to have you back at Magic.
It's lovely to be back.
It's really nice. We were having such a lovely laugh before we started rolling and before the mics went up, weren't we? And she's still laughing.
But we're not going to tell you about what it was about.
It's a secret. It's a secret. So we're talking about summer reading. What books are you planning to read this summer, apart from your own?
Well, at the moment, I'm not reading anything except a book called Black Diamonds, which is a sort of history thing about the coal industry. Sounds really boring, but it's not actually, because it's a sort of dynasty that died with when we stopped digging up coal. That's quite interesting, but it's not exactly a beach read. Mm. Recently, I've read quite a few books. The one I loved was Khaled Hussein. Is that how you pronounce his name? I'm not sure. That did The Kite Runner, the new one, The Mountains Echoed.
Yes, I know who you mean.
Absolutely loved that. Mm-hmm. Fantastic book. I've got a whole heap on my Kindle, which I left at my daughter's by accident, and so I can't even refresh my memory by telling you what ones I've got lined up. That one about the 100-year-old man that jumped out the window and disappeared,
goodness.
Whatever it's called.
Right.
That was a bizarre story, but interesting. Gone Girl was great.
Yeah. So you are a reader.
Oh, yes.
As well as a writer.
Oh, very much
because
so.
Because some people that I've interviewed, they write and then they leave the offering there. Probably might read their own work, but don't always
I don't know how you could be a writer
and not read, right.
No, because you need to know what's going on there. And I'm inspired by the writers. I don't mean I'm nicking their ideas, not by that at all. You know, you read a line, I think, and in that The Mountains Echoed, there were lines in that I thought, gosh, I wish I'd written that, you know?
Do you ever take people's writings and think, oh, where did they get that flow, that, you know? I have a friend who's just a beautiful speaker. He's a master of questions. He's a wizard with words. And sometimes I wish I had that wizardry. Do you know what I mean?
Yes. Well, I think you're either born with that or... You know,
you ain't got it.
You haven't got it. It's a bit like the storytelling ability. I think you can learn to write well, but you can't make a storyteller. They're born, I think.
Yeah.
So there is a difference. And I'm definitely the storyteller category rather than the writer, I think.
Well, I don't know about that. Lesley, what in your opinion makes the ideal summer read when you're getting books ready for the beach bag? You know, is it chick lits, mysteries, murders, action books?
Chick lit books don't do a lot for me. Having said that, I've got quite a few friends who write them, and so I do read theirs. I'm particularly fond of Katie Ford, and we're related by our dogs. So,
all right.
I always read hers, yes. she's got his brother and his mother, Stan's brother and mother. So I always read her, and she's lovely because I could be in the kitchen with her cooking me up something for lunch and she's telling me this story while I'm reading
it. How wonderful.
So to me, it's got to be a book that drags you in and you cannot come out of it. You've got to finish it. And they're getting harder and harder, I find, to find now. I don't know if I'm looking in the wrong place. Mm. I also like great big fat books because I read so fast. I had one day where I was in South Africa and I read three books in a week.
Wow.
And I was alone in the hotel room a lot in the evenings and I was just gulping them down. And it was the one, We Must Talk About Kevin was one I remember. And that was a book that sucked you in.
But I do love when a book sucks you in and you think, right, one more page and then something happens. I love when that happens.
Yes.
I love when that happens. I heard you mention the word Kindle, and one of my questions was, do you pack multiple books to go on holiday, or do you take one Kindle and download multiple books?
Yes, I download multiple books, but I still would much rather have the real books.
Hold the book.
I think we kind of do writers a bit of a disservice with Kindle. For one thing, I can't remember the titles and the author's name sometimes because it only appears on the first page in the Kindle. It doesn't appear on every page.
No.
And there again, you know, sometimes when a book is confusing you a bit, you can turn it over and read the back page and you think, oh, right, that's
the Kindle.
That was about. No. Well, there isn't a back page, is there, in a Kindle?
But you've got a Kindle.
you know, the blurb on the back, you know, that tells you something. And also you haven't got that picture because the picture kind of focuses your mind a bit.
Absolutely.
Gives you an idea about where you're going with this story.
And I think as well, with books, it's about their colour. It's about the feel. If it's a paperback, if it's a hardback, it's that writing down the spine. Mm. It's the whole creative product of what a book is. As much as I love a Kindle, and I do use it when I go on holiday, because I'd rather download seven books than take seven books, but there's something about having that book in your hand.
And if I've really liked a book, like I like The Mountains Echoed, I'm going to have to buy it because I want it on my shelves with his other ones. And, you know, when I read his other two books, I bought them in paperback.
Mm.
And I want the third one to go with them.
Yes, because it's a set.
Yes, yeah. but because I absolutely love them, because it actually defines where you've been that year, doesn't it, what you've read, you know. My agent gave me a little book one day to write down all the books I'd read, you know, as a special one. It was, you know, and you write your comments on it, which was great, but I keep forgetting to update that. So when people said to me, what have you read?
I don't know.
And then when someone mentions the title, oh, yes, that was the one where so-and-so and so happened.
Now, your book, Forgive Me, it's coming out on paperback, isn't it?
Yes.
It is indeed.
On the 16th.
So tell us, what are you working on next? And I know you're already writing something, aren't you?
I'm doing a third book in the trilogy of Belle and the Promise.
Ah.
So lots of people would be pleased about that.
I'm sure we were talking about that earlier.
It's set
in the
Second World War, so it doesn't take you long to work out that poor Etienne is now 60, but he's still got it. And Belle is still as impossibly beautiful and everything. But it's not so much about them, but a family member.
Right, okay. Or in the next generation?
Yes.
Right, okay, leave it there. Okay. Now, a lot of your books are being passed down from generation to generation. It's almost as if, you know, Mum's read this and then she says to her daughter, you've got to read this Lesley Pearse book. And that's what we love about your work. It's multi-generational. It appeals to all.
Yes, isn't I've had old ladies of sort of 90. I mean, I had a lovely neighbour who was in her 90s once, and she was a very, very bright lady, had been to Oxford when she was a girl. And she said to me, you know, the good thing about getting old and losing your memory, I can read your book today and I can read it again tomorrow and enjoy it just as much.
Brilliant.
Which I thought was a really hilarious thing to say. But yes, they do seem to go all age groups, right down to 13-year-olds, you know.
Yeah.
I'm not always quite certain how appropriate that is for someone so young.
Well, but how does that make you feel? Because there are some books that I know I could not pass to my 14-year-old. Mm. I just can't. But regardless of the subject matter of your books or how steamy it is, you know, or not.
I think I've got a strong moral compass. That's my excuse. That I don't think I would lead anybody into really bad ways through anything I've written. You know, I did have one of my daughters remark about the scene in Belle where the girls are all in the garden, the girls in the cat house, drinking lemonade.
Okay.
And my daughter said, I actually fancied working there. And I thought, oh dear, you know, that wasn't the image I wanted to give. But I think, you know, as long as the story is told with a moral compass so that you know who's the goodies and who's the baddies and it's not so ambiguous, I think that's probably okay. I mean, I can remember reading Lady Chatterley's Lover when I was 14, just for the shock value.
Yes.
And I loved the story and I felt ashamed that I'd only got hold of it to read the smutty bits.
The smutty bits.
Mm.
And did you enjoy the smutty bits?
Yes, I mean, I don't know that I fully understood it, actually. It was just one of those things. I seem to remember about a hairy bottom at one time, which made me feel a bit ill. But I actually read Sons and Lovers after that, which I found on my parents' bookshelf. And my stepmother said to me after I'd finished reading it, she said, it was so much better a book than Lady Chatterley. And she said, and yet he's always going to be known for that.
Mm.
And I thought, my goodness, she's read it.
Oh my goodness.
She knows that, but you know, Sons and Lovers was such a beautiful book. It was, you know, so in a way it was a bit of a shame really that, you know, I was reading it for something grubby. You know?
But as you say, you enjoyed the whole book. And that is that. It's been a pleasure talking to you. It always is.
And a pleasure being here.
Will you come back and see us when your next book's finished?
I certainly will, yes.
Please do. Lovely talking to you. And now I know you've got a Kindle, I shall go and download loads of books on mine.